So this is a test image with a Nikon 28mm 1.4 at f9, and everything looks fine at 100%. You see it here, it would make for a nice, really big print. This is a 32-inch screen, so you can imagine this is gonna be a big print if it was ever printed. And then I said, what if I use the perspective control lens, turn the camera in profile mode, and shoot specifically one. This is the image on the right, and as you can see further right, you can see here I don't see any chromatic aberrations, any fringing. It's almost like the previous one. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 images. This is the further one with the lens all the way to the left, and again, no purple fringing. Everything is sharp, everything is nice. This lens is particularly sharp, so let's stitch them together. So I stitched them together and I'm getting this out of Photoshop. I didn't process them at all. I just stitched them together. And this now has, look at this, purple fringing. What appears to be purple fringing, right? Now, there should be inside here too, because these are individual images, but it's not as pronounced. There is some here. There is definitely a lot here. So I say, how come the purple fringing appeared? Well, it's not in the RAW files. So I open up the images in Adobe Camera Raw again, and I notice that this time there is purple fringing that did not appear with my other software when I was opening the images. But I also notice white balance here, it says custom. Why is it custom? S shot, I want it S shot. And when I put it S shot, there it goes away. Look at that. And this, look, custom, it says custom. Why custom? Look what happens when I put it S shot. It's gone. The purple fringing is gone. So I'm gonna do that with all the images and I'm gonna run it again. Because the panorama in the first attempt, as you can see, has all this fringing. It's a big picture though, and it's got excellent detail. This is a JPEG, by the way, a final JPEG, because it wouldn't save the TIF file so big without discarding the layers. I discovered that later, so I saved the JPEG just to open it quickly. Look at these two guys here. See these two guys here? And this is the panorama without the fringing, with the corrected images, supposedly. Now, kind of like a little green fringing appeared all of a sudden. All right. And this is a little upscaled and with additional sharpness a little bit. You can almost read the sign here, which is quite impressive, right? But what are the guys? So here is the problem now. In the first attempt to the left, on the left side, I saved 5 TIF files from Adobe Camera Raw, then let Photoshop combine them into one JPEG. On the right image, we have where I corrected the white balance as shot and saved them as PSD files, Photoshop files, and then combine them with the same method. What are the guys? They're not even at the edge of a shot from what I see here, because they happen to be in the middle of the picture, and the separate images are separated here, so they're not somewhere at the edge of one picture, and they're gone. Despite that, there is, in this image here, you see here there is a faint line, again in the middle, a faint line here. I don't know if you can see it, maybe you can see it in the smaller copy here. It doesn't appear over here. So the method of saving them as PSD files kind of worked, but to eliminate the line in the middle, but it also eliminate these two people, completely erase them out of the picture and replace them with context. And I had no mysterious settings or anything like that. If anybody has any idea why this is happening, or the bird is gone too. Look at the bird. It's gone too. Why this is happening, if anybody has any idea, hit me a line underneath, or I will just be forced to buy a separate software that I can trust. In other news, I took the Otus with me because I always wanted these dramatic backgrounds in the forest, the very cinematic look that it gives. And it's also good for family portraits and stuff like that. I like this dramatic background. Now, the thing is that here I use the flash, as you can see, but I step backwards. I lowered the diffuser of the flash, the diffuser that the flash has in it, that you flip in the front, and I step back about 2 or 3 meters away from the camera with a remote flash, because when you use it a TTL just like that, even at one step under, you result into something like that. So you have to step a little backwards or reduce it furthermore, but I found it easier to just step backwards. But I'm always carrying it with me because I like how the lens renders, and you know, you can crop in something that looks like a camera, a commercial from the 70s or something. My daughter was trying the 70-200 f4, the f-mount lens on the Nikon Z6, and it is slower than when you use a native lens on the Nikon mirrorless body, and it's not always accurate unless you get used to it. You train your eye a little bit with it. You see, missed here. She started kind of getting it. Here she got it. She was sitting on the bench. We were tired at that point because the whole area was mud. Mud and water puddles and stuff. I like this pose. You know, so here in this picture, she started achieving better accuracy, but the lens was also slower than it is on the D850, a lot slower. With the D850, even with the battery almost out, it was in the red. At some point the camera stopped working. It was just great. It missed a couple because you have uniform contrast in the area and relatively low light, but it was good. With the D850, it had no problem overall. On another topic, my daughter was taking these pictures back in March. Remember when I was telling you about finding items inside the image? And one of those had an internal composition that I could work with. That's just a part of the image. And I will print this and give it to her. Which brings me to a dilemma here. This is one third of an image that was shot in Michigan in a park, middle of the day, handheld, D850 Voigtlander 125 at 2.5 aperture. And back then I had not noticed the B. I was trying desperately to focus somewhere because it was middle of the day, the sun was hitting the screen of the camera. At any rate, I noticed the B afterwards. So now I crop this one third of the image, which is a nice composition. But if I print it 13 by 19, the B is hardly going to be visible. It's going to be relatively small. Now, if I print it at 100%, it is quite an impressive image. A lucky shot, I would say. But now the print is gigantic. What you see here is 32 inches in diameter, only the part that you see. It's going to be gigantic. So that's a dilemma in prints, what to do, right? Coming up in one of the next videos will be a test of this thing here that I bought back in January, and I haven't tried it yet because I'm not really interested in macro, but I was really curious about that supposedly extra macro thing, macroscopic lens. The problem now when you get the lens very close to the item is how you're going to light up the item. And I refuse to buy any ring lights and stuff. I'm gonna try with regular light bulbs placed in such a way as to light up the item somehow. I'm gonna try to figure it out, and I'm gonna show you. It's gonna be fun. I'm gonna do that over the weekend. By the way, I sold the Nikon 105 1.4, an excellent lens, but I was not using it really. And I have an upcoming test on whether it is worth keeping all these three lenses. Now, the Nikon was excellent lens for those who want to shoot portraits at this focal 105 or 85 or something like that. It's an incredible lens. But I'm more lately into this dramatic Otus kind of thing, although it's a pain in the ass to focus. The Nikon was focusing tack sharp all the time. So anyway, upcoming test, these three. Is it worth keeping all these three, or should I sell one of them? And I'm not seeing myself selling the Nikon Zoom. It's an incredible lens and very fast. Good rendering and everything, so I don't know. We'll see. On my commenting side, what's in a photograph? It says here, time machines and legacies. I think I covered this subject at this video of mine, Life and Photography. And it also explains why when the house is burning down, we rush in to get cash, valuables, our papers, and old photographs. We're not going to save photographs or even prints of high resolution and things like that that we have already at Google Drive somewhere. We're going to save the grandpa's photographs. Photographer captures incredible 16K HDR time-lapse using two cameras. Remember when I said in one of the comments, what happens if a Nikon goes down? I said I'm going to buy another D850 and have three of them with the duct tape. But at any rate, I kind of like one of the comments that says here, cool, going to watch that on my 16K monitor. The other guy says, I'm going to watch it on my Apple Watch. You know, here's the problem. The problem is that right now, Dell is making an 8K monitor, 32-inch, which is 33 megapixels, 8K, and 32 inches to put all these megapixels, you need to have 300 ppi. And I don't care how good your vision is, you cannot really distinguish details in that kind of resolution. So to see all 33 megapixels, pixel for pixel at 100%, and be able to distinguish the differences, you need to get a much bigger monitor. Yes, 8K, you got all your 33 megapixels, but the size of the monitor has to be bigger so that your human eyes can actually distinguish the difference. And that is why photo editors prefer a resolution around 110 and 120 ppi so that they can see which parts of the images are sharp and not sharp, and all that other jazz, which area is in focus and what's not in focus.
These are both A3 images, so you can see that one is the Fuji X-T3 and one is the GFX 50R. So, you know, looking at these images, and I can look fairly close up, it's very, very, very difficult to tell the difference between them. You can start to see edges because the
Now, you're only going to see some difference at this size if you change the lenses. If you put a crappy lens on the one and an excellent lens on the other, so that the excellent lens will have better acutance and better color rendering, let's say. But other than that, to see the difference, you got to print a lot larger. That's what most people don't realize, because everybody thinks in terms of the 300 ppi or the 200 ppi.
First glance, the prints are indistinguishable and both look very sharp with vibrant colors. Let's take a closer look and see if we can see a difference once we zoom into the actual print. As you can see, in the 300 ppi file prints, we have great detail in the eyebrows and eyelashes, and as we scroll down here, you can see great detail in the pores on her skin. Now let's go to the 150 ppi file printed, and as you can see, what appears to be exact same detail in the eyes, eyelashes, and pores and skin as well. And as we compare side by side, there is just not a recognizable difference between the two at all. We also asked a few photographers to blindly identify the prints as to which one had more detail and clarity, and we got a different choice every time.
And you guys also remember this video of mine in this channel that is titled Acrylic Print 20 by 30 inches from 12 megapixels, which is a small crop with a Voigtlander 58 on the D850, and I cropped a small 12 megapixels, and the detail is astonishing in everything, and I actually reduced the clarity to create some dreamy effect on the image. Now, it is nice to have a lot of pixels and stuff, but there comes a point where if you go higher, you don't really see any returns anymore. That's it, because of our physical limitations. Because even if in the future we get these 150-inch gigantic wall-size monitors, you know, can you imagine something like that? With incredible resolution and everything, in order to see the entire image, you have to step back. Unless you want to move your head from left to right until you get dizzy, you have to step back. And when you start stepping back, you don't see the details anymore. So it all goes wasted, in my opinion. Unless, of course, we're talking about investigative issues or some crazy super cropping where you crop, I don't know, 1/100th of the image. Here is when I cropped less than 1/100th of the image from this picture with a DA10 and the Nikon 105DC. That's less than 1/100th of the image. Now, one would say, yeah, but what if I do want to super crop the crap out of everything? Sure, yeah, but in this case, you also lose the bokeh aspect. You know, regardless of what kind of aperture you're using, when you super crop, you lose this perspective. Everything becomes very compressed, right? So regardless, it's better to use the correct lens than just use a lens that will look very flat when you super crop a small part just for the sake of super cropping. People are creating classic paintings as hilarious photos in quarantine. That's actually an excellent idea, and I love this. I love this one here. The UN, the largest coffee shop in the world, is asking creatives to work for free while people in the UN who manage the projects are gonna get paid really nice salaries and benefits. A note to vintage lenses and how I stopped giving a damn about sharpness. True, you should buy a lens if you like the output of the lens, regardless of sharpness or this or that. It depends on the purpose. Unfortunately, lately, the last 2 or 3 years, cameras and gear in general has been sold in the context of lifestyle. For example, oh, I'm gonna buy myself a backpack and all of a sudden I'll become an adventurer because I bought a backpack. That's not how it works. There are some brands, and Fuji comes to mind, have been really aggressive lately with the whole issue of street photography. You know, there's selling the lifestyle of it. In the vast majority of cases, it ends up with a guy on a couch checking his camera left and right and then putting on the shelf and then talking in forums about it. The instant camera for kids uses cheap thermal paper for prints. You know, I bought this Fuji Instax for my daughter, and although they like the stuff, they didn't really take many pictures with the friends a few months ago when I bought it for Christmas. They took only the 3 or 4 pictures and then they abandoned it. I mean, they like the stuff, the new generation. They like this supposedly old-fashioned stuff. But the output was really terrible. Didn't even compare to the old Polaroids I have. The Polaroid was pretty good, the old Polaroids I have from the early 80s. The Instax was a huge disappointment in that regard. I didn't expect it. So I don't know. And another test coming, because I bought this crap. Let's see if it works. The power of selective color adjustments in Photoshop. You know, these are all fun to play with, but you should always consider that sitting for hours in front of a computer will have detrimental negative effects to your health. So having said that, there are a lot of videos lately about these topics on the calibration panels and split toning, and they're very heavy in pushing Lightroom. Now, of all these, I think that the best one is this guy who says signature edits. Why? Because he shows many examples, and what exactly he's doing. Now, here is my adventure. These are all the steps that I went through to realize that I already had everything that I needed to do all that stuff from the beginning. In Adobe ACR, I didn't need Lightroom. I didn't need the new versions. I actually deactivated any instance of automatic updates or anything like that in the new configuration, which was pretty much uninstalling all the crap that I installed and reinstalling the old software that works fast and correct with Windows 7. So if you have Windows 7, I would recommend working with the older versions, that you can find in Adobe CC, because the newer versions need Windows 10 supposedly to use your graphics card acceleration and all that other stuff. And the old ones work just fine, same thing, much faster. The time I wasted 2.5 hours. Which brings me to the conclusion of this video. If you're not failing with what you already have, do not upgrade. I mean, many of us have lost hours and hours with unlucky upgrades, either in gear or software. They're not seamless, they're not problem-free. And in the vast majority of cases, they don't contribute to anything. If you're not already failing with what you have, there is no reason to upgrade. You're just wasting time and money. Thanks a lot. Bye.